your blood runs orange and blue, orange and blue. This is the pod, is the pod for you. You're listening to Orange and Blue Bloods, hosted by EJ Stewart and Tommy Beard. Let's get to it, New York.
I guess the Lakers suffered a heartbreaking OT loss on Saturday to the Boston Celtics. By the way, what did you make of that LeBron, like, whatever that was? I don't know what that was. But I mean, he went crazy on a clear missed call. I mean, he obviously got
that was a bad call. That was a
Call. It was. I mean, we thought that, you know, RJ thing was debatable. Oh, you know, this was like 10 times worse than that. I mean, he just got raked on the arm and the ref just missed it. But I mean, LeBron is like, he's on his knees banging on the floor. I mean, I've rarely seen players get like that, let alone LeBron James. And what did you make just even of that scene on Saturday?
A wild scene, a wild finish to a wild game. In a sense, you know, obviously there are going to be memes made of it, but I think LeBron was truly and genuinely shocked, you know, like he just couldn't believe what had happened. I mean, and I don't think any, because if we have, and Van Gundy talked about it, like if we have replay in the NBA, how could we not replay? That's the type of situation that we need to prevent from happening. And refs, you know, came out afterward and said we're heartbroken and the union and yada yada yada. But that's a play you can't miss. That's a player, you know, three games away from becoming the greatest scorer of all time, one of the greatest players in NBA history. Just a powerful, you know, obviously incredibly talented offensive force going to the basket. And he's not going to miss a layup and, you know, hit front rimmed it. It just was, if anything, that's the type of thing where you call the foul and then you give the Celtics the opportunity to challenge it if they so choose to. But, you know, clearly it was, you know, so I empathize with LeBron in the sense that, and the Celtics, I mean, they're 13th in the West right now. Yes, they're only like three games out of sixth, but like every win is important, especially when they likely knew that they were going to sit out, you know, Monday against Brooklyn. So this game took on added importance. And there's only so many of these close losses that they can let slide. So, you know, I think the King I couldn't believe what had happened.
Yeah, he was incredulous to what happened. That reaction was something else. I think it does speak to his level of competitiveness, though.
Yes.
You know, people will say, you know, he's only padding stats. He doesn't really care about whether the Lakers win or lose. I mean, that was a game that, you know, like you said, they are in a play-in hunt. I wouldn't call it a playoff hunt, but they're in a play-in hunt for sure. And that's a game that would have been great. You beat the team with the best record in the NBA. That's a huge win. And you know, to miss that call was wild, and it does lead to a conversation about replay and what can and can't be challenged. Should play guys have more challenges than just one? You know, should there be an automatic, you know, New York review, kind of like we see in the NFL for certain like scoring plays? Like, I don't know, but yeah, that kind of play can't happen. But man, thanks to LeBron James and Patrick Beverley for giving us some of the best reactions to a missed call that we've ever seen. Patrick Beverley finding someone with a DSLR camera and bringing it onto the court. Maybe the most well-earned technical foul I've ever seen in an NBA game. So classic stuff from those gentlemen. We should be seeing at least some of them on Tuesday. LeBron James, like you said, is sitting out. He has a sore ankle in this game in Brooklyn on Monday. Anthony Davis is still recovering from the foot injury that he dealt with. You know, he was out for like a month with that foot injury. So he's also going to be sitting out the front end of this back-to-back. I would assume that means they will play the second end of the back-to-back, considering his Madison Square Garden national TV game against the Knicks. So number one, how did the Knicks get a W on Tuesday? Let's assume that James and Davis are in the lineup.
Yeah, I was happy to see. I'm going to be in the building tomorrow for the
Oh, that's awesome.
The Lakers Knicks game. And when I saw that the LeBron and AD were not playing Monday, I was like, yes, because that I thought, you know, like in furtherance of our other point, like it's clear which team, which building, you know,
right,
opposing players want to play in, you know, like
yeah, exactly.
They made a conscious choice to make sure that they were healthy and ready for the Garden. So it should be and getting the opportunity to watch LeBron. You know, I think I've only missed one game in his career that he's played, whether it's Cav, a Heat, a Laker, he's played at MSG, and then I missed all the other games. I started covering the league in 2004, mm-hmm. you know, started getting press credentials and whatnot. So 2003's rookie year, I bought a ticket, but since then I've, you know, been fortunate enough to have press passes or whatever. And just, there's so many great memories of him at the Garden. You know, the near 50-point triple double.
Yeah.
Where they took that rebound or assist away in the last couple minutes. And it's funny, you know, like people ask, like, you know, what's your, you know, LeBron greatest memory or most, you know, like, the, to me, one of the memories that kind of encapsulates who he is as a player and just the greatness of LeBron James.
Yeah.
Was the game, that 50-point 10-9, you know, 50-10-9 game he had at the Garden. It was the end of the first half. And I want to say he had 30 in the first half. Like he was putting on a show. It was clear that he, you know, he was in really like apex prime LeBron attack mode. And he came down the floor and had an open 3-pointer right at the buzzer. Ended up dishing it to Ben Wallace, who's right under the basket. And the Cavs were up like 18 at the time. Like they were going to win the game. It's the terrible Knicks teams of the late 2000s. But he made the right basketball play instead of going into the break, you know, with 37 instead of 34 and, you know, the Garden going crazy. Like he made the right basketball play, found his teammate under the basket for an open dunk to give his team 2 points and increase their chances of winning the game. I just say that to say that privileged and lucky to live in the era of LeBron James. The fact that he's still doing what he's doing is incredible. The numbers and the points he's putting up, the assists, rebounds, the averages, you know, basically averaging 38 since he turned 38, just things we've never seen before. Just it's something to keep in mind. Let's respect greatness while we have a chance to do so. As far as the game in and of itself tomorrow, obviously, the you know, you got to focus on LeBron. He's the guy that especially with their limited assets, we don't know what we're going to see from AD, who's working his way back, but clearly isn't the, you know, 100% yet. So you got to stay in front of LeBron. Obviously, a lot of challenges, you know, a lot of defensive assignments will get mixed matched because he's basically the point forward. Randle, it's good. You know, obviously Randle's going to have to do a great job of staying in front of of an elite player and also making LeBron work, depending on how the Lakers want to cross match. Same way, you know, we talked about the Nets and Kyrie, you got to cut off the head of the snake, and that's obviously LeBron.
Yeah. First of all, you're really lucky to be able to see all those MSG LeBron games. LeBron has had some stellar performances there. The Knicks have had some really great wins against LeBron as well. I mean, forget the Mario Hezonja defensive stop on LeBron late to seal one of those wins. So these games are normally really, really great. LeBron usually gets up for them.
Yes.
So it should be another good one on Tuesday. I think the Knicks are in a weird position in this game because I don't necessarily feel like they're – not that any team's a great matchup for LeBron, but I don't know if the Knicks necessarily are the greatest matchup in terms of how to guard LeBron. Like, you're right, Julius Randle's going to get a lot of the reps, which he's going to have to really, one, stay out of foul trouble, and two, kind of keep his head because, you know, the refs, considering what happened on Saturday, sure we'll have a very close eye on LeBron drives, and Julius got to keep his cool. He can't get attacked or anything like that if he gets some bad whistles guarding LeBron. But after Julius, you know, you kind of look at who are the next guys. I mean, RJ has guarded him in the past, so RJ will get time, but, you know, RJ is going to have a big size disadvantage. Quentin Grimes would have a massive size disadvantage. So, I mean, I'm sure he'll get some possessions, but I can't imagine he's definitely not going to be the primary defender on him. So, not that many options for the Knicks to throw at. This is kind of where these problems come with terms of the lack of wing combo forward defenders that the Knicks don't have. Obi Toppin is not a defender at this point in his career. So, LeBron could have a big game. Like, this kind of sets up well for him potentially, you know, unless Julius is able to rise to the challenge defensively. Now, when he got the opportunity to guard Giannis last month, he was spectacular defensively. He had a terrible offensive game in that loss, but his defense was incredible. So I think Julius could rise to this challenge, but it's going to be a challenge because we know the Kings want to put on a show at MSG. I think that is definitely one of the big matchups to watch. I will be curious also to see, you know, what happens with AD in terms of how the Knicks will have to, you know, match up with him, because he's going to be going up against Sims, who's extremely, green, big man who hasn't seen probably player's caliber or Anthony Davis. Say Harden's on course is going to get a lot of time as well. I would wonder if the Knicks implore smaller lineups against the Lakers, and if there's something that you can try, because the Lakers will play kind of a positionless style. Every time with LeBron, will essentially play the five because they don't necessarily have great five men. So this is a chance you see Obi and Randall at the five. I'm also looking to see if there's a time where they are able to get RJ at the four and put IQ in there and then go super small, where you got Brunson, IQ, Grimes, RJ, and Randall. If there's a time, there's a chance where the Lakers go small and LeBron's playing as a five, or if there's a five man that just isn't really all that much of a threat. I think this is a great game to kind of, you know, test that. Like, I think that that's a line that they definitely need to be looking at. So those things I will be following in this one on Tuesday.
You know who the Knicks could use? A guy like OG Anunoby maybe to guard LeBron. We'll segue into the next conversation. But yeah, I'm curious about AD too. He's come off the bench his first two games since returning from injury. You know, that Thomas Bryant had been playing well at center for the Lakers, so they left him in the lineup. So we'll see if AD maybe returns to starting lineup. This will be his third game back a week after his return from the foot injury and a day off, obviously not playing Monday. It'll be interesting to see. And then Obi, could Obi play some time? We've talked about that. Played less than 10 minutes again Saturday night in Brooklyn. If the Knicks went small with Randall at the five, I'd love to see some Randall and Obi. And again, as we, the last segment here, we'll talk about the trade deadline. February 9th, 10 days away. I've harped on this point for the last week or so. If the Knicks aren't going to play Obi more than 10 minutes a night, and you're not, that means you're likely not going to resign him or sign him to a contract extension this summer. They owe it to themselves to explore any and all opportunities when it comes to trading him. I think you'd be selling low. I think it'd probably be a mistake. But again, we mentioned it, in relation to the Rui Hachimura deal that we'll see Tuesday night at the Garden.
Yeah.
The Wizards got a 2028 second round pick, a 2029 second round pick, and a second round pick next year, along with Kendrick Nunn's expiring contract. So, Hachimura is a guy that averaged 14 as a rookie, that's averaged 14 points in 30 minutes a night for his career, can shoot the three, has some versatility, has been far more productive. In terms of, production, maybe not per minute or upside or whatever, however you want to classify it. But Obi again, and he's not his puppy, he's 24 years old, 2 years older than RJ. That's the type of return you're going to get for Obi if you look to trade him next February when he's on the verge of becoming a free agent, as opposed to, if you don't feel, and with Tibbs and Randall, who's played more minutes than any player in the NBA since the start of last season, if those two guys are in New York, there's really not a spot for Obi Toppin in New York. So therefore, if you're going to explore trade opportunities, I think that's one of the guys we'll keep an eye on over the next week.
Yep, trade deadline February 9th. Knicks, Lakers, Tuesday, 7:30 TNT. Should be an interesting game to follow.